Wave Sound Audiobooks presents Beyond Fear by Jaye Ford, narrated by Kirsty Gillmore. Chapter 1. They were going north this year, just the four of them, heading out again on a cold winter's Friday night. Jodie smiled as she drove, watching the lights of a small town disappear in her rearview mirror. There was a hint of mist in the bush on either side of the road, and her headlights cut an eerie passage in the darkness, like a tunnel guiding her safely through the night. Or straight to hell. Jodie stifled a shudder at that ugly thought. She knew about taking the wrong tunnel, and the places it could lead you. But that's not going to happen, she told herself. Not now. Not with these friends. Here, have some chocolate. Louise held out the broken-up block of fruit and nut next to Jodie. Ray'll be on his way to swim club about now. I'm eating chocolate and he's running around after both sets of twins. It's great. Jodie checked the clock on the dashboard. James should be picking up Adam and Isabel from the birthday party. There was a heap of red cordial and lollies when I dropped them off. He'll be begging them to go to bed in a couple of hours. She grinned at the thought of the two ramped-up kids her ex would have to deal with, and tossed a square of chocolate in her mouth. Good choice, Hannah. Ta, Hannah said, leaning over the back of Louise's seat to take a piece. Pete's on carpool duty for basketball tonight. That means he gets to cart around stinky kids, shout Mac is on the way home, and have dinner with Mum, who's looking after Chelsea. He loves our weekends away, I tell you. Bailey and Zoe are staying with the Outlaws. Is it too early to crack the champers? Jodie lifted her eyes to the rearview mirror again and grinned at Corinne and the champagne bottle she was holding aloft. I brought plastic flutes in case of an emergency, Corinne added. What kind of an emergency would that be? Jodie asked. I'd say no alcohol at 6:15 on day one is definitely an emergency. Jodie laughed, but as she rounded the next bend, the sound died in her throat. A car was in the centre of the two-lane road, lights on high beam, maybe 100 metres away, coming at them fast. Its movement was loose and uncontrolled, lurching one way, then the other. Jodie's heart banged in her chest. At the speed they were going, if she didn't do something quickly... She took a solid grip on the wheel, remembered her defensive driver training, and resisted an urge to slam the brake through the floor. She touched her foot to the pedal, swerved left. The tyres on that side skipped off the road, and a hailstorm of stone sprayed the doors. Someone in the back screamed. Beside her, Louise braced herself against the dashboard. The other car roared past so close, Jodie could have reached out and touched it. The rush of wind that followed pushed her car further onto the dirt. The tyres couldn't get traction. The rear end fishtailed violently. The front lurched sideways in the start of a fast, wide arc. Her headlights swept across dark scrub, then the dirt at the edge of the road, then the two-lane strip of bitumen. Jodie pulled against the steering wheel, desperate to drag it off its circular course. Minutes, hours, probably only microseconds later, the car tilted out of its spin, reverse direction. The light swept back across the road, across the dirt. Then Jodie saw what was going to stop them. The reflective dot on top of the white marker post glowed like a beacon in the headlights for about half a second before it slammed into the grill. Jodie was thrown hard against her seatbelt as the car thumped to a stop. Her foot was locked on the brake, her fingers held their death grip on the steering wheel. For a long moment, no one said a word. The engine gurgled, the white post was somewhere underneath it, and the sound of breathing seemed to fill the car. "Is everyone okay?" she finally said. Oh, my God! Jesus H. Christ! Fucking hell! Jodie rubbed her chest where the seatbelt had cut in. Is that a yes from everyone? She turned off the ignition and looked over each friend to make sure. Louise's mass of curly hair had fallen over her face, and she had one hand on her chest, the other on her knee, rubbing gently. Hannah still gripped the back of Louise's seat, but she smiled grimly at Jodie. Corinne held the champagne bottle with both hands, like she was clutching a lamppost in a hurricane. Thank God the champers are safe. We're really going to need it now, Corinne said, without a hint of humour. Jodie felt a wave of relief before anger charged in behind it. What a bastard! What the hell was he doing? He could have killed us! She pushed her door open, slammed it behind her, stomped around to inspect the damage. Bastard! Look at my car! It had come to a stop on rough gravel about a metre off the road. Dense scrub was no more than a giant step from the passenger side doors, and the glow from the one headlamp still working was the only light on what looked to be a very dark, isolated stretch of road. The car itself was a mess. The front looked as though it had been hit by a battering ram. A deep cleft was gouged into the left half of the grille. The hood on that side was crushed, and the mangled end of the bumper was lying on the dirt. Jodie looked up as the light came on inside the car. Louise had opened the door, was speaking to Corinne and Hannah. She couldn't hear what Lou was saying, but she kept flashing her hand across her face as though she was reliving the moment the car sped past. Corinne was leaning into the centre of the car, hugging the champagne bottle to her chest, and Hannah looked white under the dim overhead light. Jodie's stomach tightened. She'd almost killed her best friends, almost destroyed four families. She put a hand to her mouth, swallowed hard against nausea rising in her throat. Her hand started to shake, trembled all the way back to her shoulder and rattled down her spine. Oh, God, she didn't want blood on her hands. Not again. Her knees buckled, and she landed on her butt in the dirt. Someone squatted beside her, put an arm around her shoulders. Hey, it's okay. It was Louise. She felt Hannah's firm nurse's hand between her shoulder blades. Head between your knees, Jode. Suck in big breaths. In and out. That's it. Jodie kept her eyes open, her mind in the present. They are alive, Jodie. All of them. The cold hit her then. Suddenly, as though her brain had just got around to processing her physical state, an icy breeze sliced across her face, made the nearby scrub shush. She looked up, saw a huge, black, moonless sky. Off to her right, a champagne cork popped.
I think we all need a stiff drink, Corinne said. The plastic flutes got squashed when we were bouncing around, so we'll have to drink straight from the bottle.
Jodie watched as Corinne, lit up by the headlight in her high heels and long coat, tossed her blonde hair over her shoulders, tipped her head back, and swung the champagne bottle up in one fluid movement for a slug. Only Corinne could stand in the rubble at the side of a dark road after a near-death experience and do that with style. Jodie grinned and held out her hand.
Pass that thing over here, she said,
and wondered for the 100th time how she ended up with a friend like Corinne. Jodie couldn't do glamour. She was a high school PE teacher and a single mother of two sports-mad kids. What was the point of even trying?
So, where are we?
Corinne asked, handing the bottle over. Jodie took a mouthful and screwed up her face. Too bubbly, too cold, too much adrenaline already making her head spin.
Good question, she said.
She stood up, brushed off her jeans and looked in the direction they'd come, to where double yellow lines disappeared around a bend, then the other way, to the crest of a hill.
Somewhere outside Bald Hill, I guess. We can't be too far away. The agent said it'd take about an hour and a half from Newcastle, and we left an hour ago.
So what do we do now? Corinne asked. Jodie gripped the twisted end of the bumper and pulled on the cold metal. It groaned, but held fast.
Well, we're not going anywhere in my car. We'll have to get a tow.
I'll get my phone, Louise said, starting around to the passenger door. I put the NRMA on speed dial the last time my car broke down.
While Louise walked in circles with her arm up in a looking-for-reception pose, Jodie checked over the damage again. It was going to be a major pain without a car for the weekend, not to mention for the couple of weeks while it was being repaired. At least her insurance would cover the cost of a tow truck.
I can't get reception, Louise called from the edge of the road.
A minute later, all four of them were wandering around in the dark, phones held high.
I've got one bar, Hannah called.
She was across the road, on the edge of the bush, one side of her face lit in blue by her phone.
What's the number?
The champagne was passed around again, while Hannah handled the rescue operation.
I hope this place you booked has decent heating, Jodie. It's freezing out here,
Corinne said, pulling her coat tighter.
And a toilet. I need to pee, Louise said. And lights, because it's really dark tonight, Hannah called.
Jodie handled the bottle to Lou. It's got an open fire and two loos, and if it doesn't have lights, I'm pretty sure we could ask for our money back. It had been Jodie's turn to book the accommodation this year, and she knew only too well the success of the weekend could turn on the lodgings. 4 years ago, she booked a houseboat, a leaky houseboat, and it had rained and rained, and no amount of red wine and chocolate could make up for an overflowing loo. She was feeling more than a little pressure to come up with something fabulous.
No, seriously, it looked great on the website. 100-year-old barn. Tell me we're not staying in a barn, Corinne said. It's not a barn now. It was renovated last year. The pictures are lovely.
Corinne took the bottle from Louise and pointed it at Jodie.
Okay, but let me just make this clear. I don't care what state your car is in, you're driving me straight back home if I see anything that looks even remotely like a farm animal.
Their laughter echoed into the cold night as Corinne swung the bottle up for another slug. Jodie shook the tension out of her shoulders as the terror of the last few minutes dissipated. Nice to know a brush with death hadn't ruined the mood of the weekend.
Okay, Hannah said, coming back across the road. Road service got onto a local service station and they're sending a tow truck out. I hope you've all got your thermal undies on, because it's a half-hour drive out here.
Matt Wiseman checked out the Mazda as he swung the tow truck in a wide U-turn across the road. Nice job hitting the post, he thought. As he backed up the truck, he saw through the rear-view mirror a driver and three passengers get out. He pulled the handbrake, checked the clipboard, shook his head. Looked like the new kid his dad had employed needed some lessons in asking questions. He'd obviously missed the one about how many people were stranded with the broken-down car. Hope this lot had some other transport, or the job wasn't going to be as easy as he'd banked on.
I'll get this one, Dad, Matt had said after the call came in. I've been back 2 months. I know what to do. Go shoot a bullseye.
The psychologist was wrong. Covering for his dad so the old man could play in the Bald Hill darts final did not symbolise an innate desire to save others. It just proved he was a sentimental idiot.
He stretched his bad leg as he got out of the cab and looked across the truck bed at four women standing in the glow of his floodlight. Well, that was something you didn't see every day. Not out here on a cold Friday night. He checked the paperwork for a name, looked up again when they laughed. Stranded on a deserted road in the dark for almost an hour and still laughing. That was even more unexpected.
Evening, ladies. Everyone okay here?
Matt watched them as he walked around the truck. They were good-looking women, all four of them, mid to late 30s, probably. One of them was all done up like she was on her way to dinner. The short one on her right had a mop of dark curly hair. The one on the other side had a pretty face but was fleshy around the middle, like she'd had a couple of kids and never managed to firm everything back up again. The one on the end had funky short-cropped hair, huge dark eyes, and the legs under her short coat looked like sculpted denim.
So, which one of you is Mrs. De Crane?
The four of them giggled.
Joe De Crane? He tried.
More laughing. Then he saw the champagne bottle the dressed-up one was holding.
You ladies been drinking tonight?
He used a neutral voice, not an accusation, just an inquiry.
Absolutely,
the one with the bottle said, swinging it back and forth by the neck.
Purely for medicinal purposes, we didn't want Jodie passing out from shock.
The one with the sculpted denim leg stepped forward. Her brief laugh was a cool, low, confident roll of sound.
Hi, it's my car. I'm Jodie Cramer. You were close, you know, with the name.
She didn't look drunk, and she didn't look stupid enough to drink and drive, but you never could tell.
A breathalyzer wouldn't be able to detect whether you had the drink before or after the accident.
She lifted her chin, held the smile.
I doubt a breathalyzer would even register the couple of mouthfuls of champagne I had after the accident. But seeing as the police aren't here, and you are, it'd be great if we could start with the towing before we all freeze.
Matt watched her a moment. It was said nicely, but firmly. She was practiced at giving direction, that much was clear. At another time and place, he would have pressed her further, breathalyzed her for sure. But no one was hurt. They weren't doing any more driving in that car. And it wasn't his job anymore. At least, that's the way he felt about it tonight. He made a show of looking at the damage.
What happened?
Jodie told him about the driver who'd pushed her off the road and pointed out the post that was lodged under the engine block. She was really cheesed off. It was impressive to watch. He looked under the car, couldn't help checking out her legs as he stood up. They were lean, toned. Maybe she was a runner.
Where are you ladies heading?
He asked.
We're staying the weekend at a house just outside Bald Hill, Jodie said.
Well, they weren't going to be walking then.
Anyone there to pick you up?
The dressed-up one answered.
It's just the four of us. A girls' weekend away.
Not such a great start, huh? Well, hate to break it to you, but I can only take two of you in the truck.
There was some muttering, and someone said,
fuck it all.
He agreed. It was definitely a fuck it all situation. Jodie ran a hand through her funky short hair.
So, how far out of Bald Hill are we?
About 40 k's, half an hour in the truck.
Can we get a taxi this far out of town? On a Friday night?
Matt raised an eyebrow.
Bald Hill isn't exactly rocking on a Friday night. I'll radio our one and only cabbie on the two-way. He should be here by the time the car's up on the hoist.
He wouldn't leave them in their dark on their own anyway. It wasn't a place to leave anyone. Matt went back to the trunk, radioed Dougie, and told him not to take his sweet time about it. Told him there were four nice city women pissed at being run off the road and waiting in the cold, so he should get his ass out here quick. That guy needed a bomb under him sometimes. Matt took as long as he could to get the Mazda ready for towing, but there was still no sign of Dougie when he was done. As he radioed again, the women huddled together in the cold, the luggage they'd taken from the car in a heap beside them.
"The cabby said he's about 5 minutes away. I'll wait till he gets here. You can get in the truck to keep warm, if you want," Matt said.
Jodie stepped forward.
"We're a bit worried about the time, actually. We have to pick up a key at a shop in town by 8, and it's almost 7:30 already. If you left with two of us now, we might get there before they close."
Matt looked up and down the dark road.
"Which shop is it?"
She unfolded a piece of paper.
"Smith's Food Mart."
That made sense. It was next door to the real estate agent. He didn't know the Smiths well. They hadn't owned the place when he'd lived in Bald Hill as a kid, but everyone knew they liked to close on time. It was a fair drive to their property out of town. Matt shook his head slowly.
"It's not a great place to be waiting at night."
Jodie checked her watch.
"Look, you said yourself the cab's only 5 minutes away. It's probably just around the corner, and a couple of minutes might be the difference between getting our key and finding someplace else that can put up four people at short notice."
Matt scanned the road again. He could ring the pub and get someone to drop around to Smith's. He took his phone out of his pocket. No bars. Reliable reception was a figment of the imagination out here. He looked at Jodie. He didn't like the idea, but he could see her point. He could spend 10 minutes trying to hunt down reception, or he could hit the road and save them a lot of stuffing around. Jodie watched the tow truck driver think it through. He seemed like a nice guy, despite the breathalyzer crack. Not bad looking either. Tall, muscled without being beefy. Excellent smile. But he wasn't smiling about leaving them. She wasn't too happy about the idea either. It was damn dark out here. There was no question she'd stay behind. It was her car. Her fault, really. It was the risk she always took as the self-appointed designated driver wherever she went. Her life was in her own hands that way, with her own overblown sense of caution. But the flip side was that if anything went wrong, it was her responsibility. Staying behind wasn't the problem, though. If they didn't get the key, she'd be guilty of another houseboat weekend. And in a year's time, they'd be discussing leaking loos versus no roof over their heads. She smiled encouragingly at the driver, watched him juggle the phone in his palm for a moment. He closed his hand around it, dropped it back in his pocket, and looked down at her.
"Okay, let's get rolling," he said.
Jodie chaired a brief meeting over who was going in the truck.
"We could all stay," Hannah suggested.
"Don't be ridiculous," Jodie said. "A cab won't fit all of us and the luggage. Look, I'm staying. Lou needs to pee, so unless she wants to duck behind a dark, creepy bush to relieve herself, she should go into town."
Lou made a face, a mixture of apology and relief. Jodie turned to Corinne and Hannah. No one was volunteering now, to stay or go.
"Hannah is freezing in that thin jacket, so Corinne either gives Hannah her coat or stays with me."
Corinne boarded on skinny while Hannah was carrying a couple of extra kilos. It was unlikely Corinne's figure-hugging coat would meet around Hannah's middle. Hannah looked Corinne up and down, tugged the hem of her sweater over her belly, and tucked her short brown bob behind her ears.
"Well, I wouldn't mind, but..."
Corinne shrugged and sighed, then stood with her hands in her pockets, looking unimpressed, as Jodie passed luggage up to Hannah and Louise in the truck. When Jodie closed the door, more than half the cases were still on the dirt at her feet, and everyone, including the driver, looked unhappy about the arrangement. Brilliant bloody start to the weekend, Jodie.
Don't worry, we're fine, she said. See you in Bald Hill.
She shooed them off, waving about the torch the driver had given her, and smiling like she and Corinne were already having a ball. She stood in the centre of the road and watched the truck's headlights flare into the night sky as it crested the hill, then disappear as it dropped over the other side. She thought of the tunnel her own lights had carved in the darkness not so long ago and felt a chill at the black and lonely place she was now standing in.
Chapter 2. Better save the batteries, Jodie said, and flipped off the torch.
Night wrapped itself around them like a black shroud.
Christ, it's freezing!
Corinne's voice sounded deeper than usual in the silence of the wide open space. Jodie turned away from the road, strained her eyes in the darkness, thought she could see the faint glow of Corinne's blonde hair.
And dark. It's bloody dark. The cold's worse. No way. Dark like this gives me the creeps.
She stepped cautiously in the direction of Corinne's voice, not wanting to stumble into the luggage, willing herself not to flinch at the feeling that the night was breathing down her neck.
We should have borrowed the fluoro vest the tow truck driver was wearing. Are you kidding? That colour would look terrible on me.
Corinne's face suddenly appeared, lit in blue by Hannah's mobile phone. It was the only one that had found reception.
Okay, it's 7:32. We give the taxi 10 minutes before we start yelling down the phone.
Jodie grinned as Corinne looked up at her.
God, you look like something out of a ghost story. A decapitation victim whose head haunts the highway, terrifying drivers, causing unexplained accidents.
Corinne moved the phone under her chin so the light made her look like a glowing blue skull.
Could this face do anything but inspire a lifelong trust in good skincare?
Jodie laughed, heard Corinne's husky chuckle, and was glad her friend had decided not to stick with the huffy silence over having to wait behind.
Thanks for staying with me.
The light slid downwards and disappeared as Corinne dropped the phone in her pocket.
I guess that's what I get for having a strong bladder and a warm coat.
She said it laughingly, but Jodie got the message. It was the short straw, not a good deed. Sorry about all this.
It's not your fault that driver tried to run us off the road.
Did you get a look at the car?
Briefly. I was opening the champagne.
I thought it was one of those big chunky utes, black or something dark, with lights mounted on top, floodlights or something.
I think it had a sort of frame over the tray section, Corinne said. Fat silver posts, or maybe they were white. I only got a glimpse.
Jodie flicked the torch on, walked the 5 paces to the edge of the road, looked right to the crest of the hill, then left to the bend.
What are you doing?
Corinne asked.
I don't know, just looking. The view's the same from here, you know.
Jodie swung the torch around, lit up the bags and Corinne and the bush at her back.
Yeah, I know, but walking and looking feels better than standing still.
She left the light on as she made her way around the luggage, flicked it off, folded her arms tight across her chest. Beside her, Corinne's boots shuffled about on the roadside gravel. She could smell Corinne's perfume. Something far off made a bird-like sound. The light from the phone appeared at waist height, briefly lit Corinne's manicured hand, then disappeared again. The sound of an engine began like a whisper in the silent night, grew to a rumble, then the bush beyond the bend glowed.
Thank God, Corinne said.
Headlights speared the darkness, and a moment later, a car careered around the bend. It was going the wrong way to be coming from Bald Hill, but maybe the cab hadn't started there. Corinne slung her handbag over a shoulder, picked up a suitcase, and stood like she was waiting for the bus. Jodie walked towards the road, moving the torch from side to side in a wide arc, letting the cabbie know he'd found them. The car was almost on her before she realised it wasn't the cab. No telltale taxi light on top, no attempt to slow down. She squinted in the glare of the headlights, glanced a shadowy lone driver at the wheel as it rushed past, then watched until its red taillights disappeared over the hill.
Shit, Corinne said.
Something hit the gravel. Jodie guessed it was the bag, hoped Corinne hadn't slumped to the ground in a sulk. Jodie stepped onto the smooth surface of the road and stood in the centre, torch still pointed at the corner.
Shit.
After the blaze of light, the dark seemed even more oppressive. She didn't like it. All the way it made her heart hammer inside her chest.
What time is it?
The blue light appeared.
7:40. I'm going to call.
Jodie walked back, took Hannah's phone, crossed the road, and had a shoulder pressed into the bush on the other side before one reception bar lit up. She dialed the number the tow truck driver had given her and watched the torchlight dim a little as she listened to the ringtone switch to the cabbie's message bank. She left a polite message. We're here. We're waiting. Be great to see you soon. She phoned Louise, then the truck driver. No answer on both counts. By the time she reached Corinne, the torch beam looked like it had been connected to a dimmer and turned to low. She flicked it off, sucking in a breath at the sudden blackness.
Bloody hell, I can't see a thing.
Corinne was silent for a moment.
I can make out the top of the trees against the sky.
Jodie lifted her eyes, saw shadows materialise as her vision adjusted to the dark. The ragged edge of treetops silhouetted against a starless dome of sky, the looming solid mass of a gum tree, the white roadside markers. She sensed again the darkness at her back, wanted to turn around, check they were alone. Don't be paranoid, Jodie. You're past that. She pushed her hands into her pockets.
I can see the white lines on the road, too. I can see you. Your face, but not your hair.
Your hair looks like a puff of steam.
Thanks for that.
Any time.
Christ, it's cold.
Corinne shuffled her feet again. Jodie repositioned her weight from one frozen foot to the other, blue on her hands, hitched at the collar of her jacket. It was so quiet, she could hear her pulse thud softly inside her head. Icy tentacles of wind played across her face, rustled the bush behind her, a gentle shushing sound that was amplified in the eerie dark silence and made her feel suddenly, irrationally, alone.
Adam said you went all the way back to school for his model plane today, Jodie said loudly, a little too cheerily.
She notched it down a tad.
He's so forgetful. I hope it wasn't too much of a rush to get packed. No problem. My bags were already waiting by the door. Besides, he looked like his little heart would break if I didn't.
Jodie smiled, relieved to hear Corinne's voice.
He really wanted his dad to see it, she said, wishing she could tell Corinne how thankful she was.
Corinne had banned her from saying thank you 2.5 years ago. That was a week after Jodie had gone back to full-time work, still angry and reeling from James's decision to give up on their rocky marriage. She'd been stuck in traffic, then late to pick up Adam and Isabel from after-school care. The kids were upset. Jodie felt sick with guilt, and it had cost her a fortune in late fees. Then Corinne dropped by to see how the new job was going. She was the most unlikely candidate for childminding. The woman was so perfectly groomed and styled, it was hard to believe she had children of her own. But it was Corinne's idea. Jodie had to stay behind to teach a senior sport class on Wednesdays and Fridays, and Corinne was at the primary school anyway to collect Zoe, her youngest. So after that, Corinne picked up all three kids 2 days a week, took them home, fed them afternoon tea, and let them play until Jodie arrived. No need for thank yous, Corinne had said. She enjoyed their laughing and shouting and running around. Her late husband, Roland, had loved a raucous house. More often than not, Corinne had a chilled bottle of champagne waiting for Jodie's arrival on Fridays. Hannah or Lou might drop by, and all the kids would be shooed down to Corinne's huge rumpus room or out to the pool. Sometimes, after Hannah or Lou had gone home to their husbands, Jodie and Corinne would order takeaway or make something easy like cheese on toast, sit around the table with their four children and conjure up some of that relaxed end-of-the-week family time they both missed about being married.
"Just don't let James think I did it for him," Corinne said,
and Jodie knew she'd have that peak tilt to her chin now. Corinne had never forgiven James for walking away from his family, not when he'd seen how hers was torn apart by Roland's heart attack only months earlier. If ever Jodie needed company for a bit of liberating ex-husband ranting, Corinne was her girl. "Won't even mention it," Jodie promised, then heard the scuffle of Corinne's feet, saw her bend over the luggage.
"What happened to the champagne?" Corinne asked. "Champagne? Are you kidding? It's too cold." "Honey, it's never too cold for champagne. I saw it with the bags. Hear it? What? Oh, bugger. It got knocked over."
More scuffling.
"Ah, oh, fuck it all."
Gravel skittered across the ground.
"I've been squatting in a big puddle of champagne. It soaked the hem of my coat. Christ."
Jodie heard the muted sounds of Corinne slapping at her coat, the scrunch of gravel as she flailed about.
"Where the hell is that cab? Give me the phone. I'm going to call."
Jodie handed her the phone and the torch. She heard a couple of sighs, then Corinne said,
"How do you work this thing?" "Oh, got it."
The torch came to life, and Jodie screwed up her eyes as the beam shone straight into her face.
"Let's see what this cab driver's got to say for himself," Corinne said.
The cabbie would get an earful. Jodie grinned to herself as Corinne lit a path around the bags, but as she stalked across the road, the smile on Jodie's face dropped away. The torch beam had wiped out her night vision, and the further away Corinne got, the blacker everything became. The jagged edge of sky was gone, so was the looming tree. She thought about running over to her. They could huddle together in the light, make defamatory comments about the cabbie while they waited for him to answer. But she couldn't see her own feet, thought she'd probably do an ankle, tripping over the luggage. She pulled her coat tighter, tried to keep her eyes on Corinne, felt her chest tighten. Her heart beat faster. Where was the damn cab? And what the hell happened to 5 minutes away? They'd been waiting 15 already, freezing their butts. A snap. In the brush. Jodie spun around, blinked blindly at the darkness. Something familiar and unpleasant fluttered in the pit of her belly. Her hands turned to fists inside her pockets. She stood perfectly still, ears straining in the silence, listening. For footsteps, breathing, whispering. It was like a sensory deprivation tank out here. No sound, no sight. Then behind her, Corinne swore. Jodie jumped so hard it sent little stones scattering. Adrenaline buzzed in her head, tingled across her shoulders. She turned, saw Corinne in her halo of phone light, punching buttons on the mobile.
Get a grip, Jodie. There is no one out here. No one could be. It's just you and Corinne. The fashion queen and her tracksuit and runner's friend. Shake it off, Jodie. Take a damn breath.
Any luck?
She called it loudly, filling the darkness with the sound of her own voice.
I left a message for the cabbie and Lou's mobile rang out,
Corinne said as her heels clacked back across the road.
What the hell are they doing? They should be waiting for us to call.
Jodie felt a flicker of concern.
Maybe it's the reception out here. I could only get one bar. Maybe the calls aren't even getting through to them. They're fine. I'm sure they are. I'm sure it's just a reception problem.
Corinne skirted the luggage, came to a stop beside Jodie, and clicked the torch off at the end of a long sigh.
Leave it on, Jodie said.
My hand's cold.
I'll hold it.
The torch came back on. Jodie took it from Corinne, ran the light over the bags at their feet, then in a wider circle around the luggage, across the gravel, the skid marks in the stones, the bent-over white post. She turned around and shone the glow into the bush behind them.
See, Jodie, just bush.
The light was little more than a dim disc now. The batteries wouldn't last much longer. She should turn it off. She didn't.
So what's the latest on the school dinner?
Jodie said it like the ins and outs of the fundraising committee were prime conversation. She didn't have the time or the skills to organise a classy dinner, and Corinne's enthusiasm for table decorations and menu options had, to this point, encouraged her to steer clear of the topic. But right now, she'd be happy to hear all of it. Anything to keep them talking, to fill the silence, to take the edge off the darkness. She huffed.
The colour scheme has been such a drama this year,
Corinne started. And Jodie listened, mmmed and oh lovelied, until she couldn't stand not knowing the time any longer.
Pass the mobile?
She said, when Corinne paused for breath. She checked the glowing blue numbers. 23 minutes they'd been waiting. And as Corinne talked on, Jodie took the torch to the edge of the road, looked right to the crest, left to the bend.
I'm going to try again.
She jogged across the road and nestled into the bush. She didn't bother leaving a message for the cabbie. He wasn't going to get there any faster if she told him he was a useless, time-wasting jerk. She phoned Louise, then the tow truck driver.
Still no answer.
Then it didn't matter. Light flared in the sky beyond the crest of the hill before the car roared into sight like two blinding eyes. Jodie stepped out of the bush, had her arms in the air to flag it down when she saw Corinne on the opposite side, lit up by the headlights. She'd stepped forward, but had already seen it wasn't stopping, stood there with one hand on her hip, one leg jutted out, body language for pissed off. As it passed, a man shouted out the window in a loud rush of sound that was carried away by the speed of the car. Jodie had no idea what he yelled. It could have been praise the Lord. But she stiffened with apprehension, flicked off the torch, watched the car all the way to the bend, hoping it didn't turn around, not feeling a whole lot safer when it didn't. She sprinted back across the road as its red taillights disappeared. The dark closed in. She flicked the switch on the torch, but got nothing. Tried it again, gave it a bash with the heel of her hand. Nothing.
And?
Corinne said. Jodie tossed the torch in the direction of the luggage, heard the soft thud as it landed, edged closer to Corinne.
Still no answer. What are they doing?
It was more exclamation than question.
Must be the reception.
They're fine, Jodie. Corinne started up a rhythmic rocking, knocking one foot against the other.
I've been trying to think of something hot, she said, but it's not working. All I get is Brad Pitt, and I just can't imagine anything hot with all those kids of his hanging around.
Jodie smiled, tried to relax. The cab would come. It would be here any second.
It's been so long since I had anything hot. I'm not sure I can conjure up an image that would warm me up, kids or no kids.
I'm with you there. I haven't had a man to cuddle up to since Roland died. Well, except for that one close call.
Jodie looked at Corinne, saw Corinne's puff of steam hair turn in her direction.
Rob the sales rep,
they said together, and burst out laughing. Corinne's tale of her disastrous widow tries the dating game had kept the four of them in stitches for months. Rob the sales rep was a friend of a friend of a friend. He'd asked her out. She'd thought it was time. He was younger. She figured, what the hell? She had her hair and nails done, bought a new dress, wore 4-inch heels, and he'd taken her for pizza.
Classy pizza, Jodie said, glad to have something to take her mind off the darkness.
Pizza restaurant with a drive-thru,
Corinne returned, and their laughter cranked up. The low points of Corinne's big night out had become the punchlines to a running joke that was less about Rob and more about their anxiety over the singles scene. Out here in the cold, poor, clueless Rob was the perfect stress reliever, and they cackled through the shorthand version of the tale.
You're turning 40?
Your condoms or mine, babe?
On a first date?
Hey, you're 40. You haven't got time to wait.
Then it wasn't Rob they were laughing at, but each other. Gasping with an increasing hilarity that shook out Jodie's nerves and eased the apprehension. As the laughter finally wound down, Corinne slung an arm around Jodie's neck, laid her head on Jodie's shoulder, and let out one last long hooting laugh. The hairs on Jodie's neck stood up. Sweat broke out along her hairline. A thought stirred in the back of her head. No, a memory. It wasn't just the last long laugh. It was Corinne's sudden closeness, her breath on Jodie's neck, the dark, the cold, the pressing silence of a large open space. Then the memory hit like a thump between her shoulder blades. Images blasted through her head, crazy mixed-up images, as though the memory was a reel of film that had been chopped up and stuck back together in random order. Pink platform sandal. Man's face. Long hair. Stud earring. Chipped front tooth. Breath misting on a laugh. Feet running on gravel. Rough hands on her face. Blood on her hands. On her clothes. So much blood. So much. Chapter 3. Jodie held her hands up in front of her face, close enough to see pale palms, ringless fingers. No, there was no blood now. She shook her head, heard her lungs suck air in, let it out, suck it in again. As fear surged through her body, a part of her brain recognized the flashback for what it was, even calculated how long it had been since she'd had one. 4 years, at least. It's not happening, Jodie. They're memories, old memories. But it was so hard to hear herself over the terror.
This is a bad place to be. She grabbed Corinne by the sleeve. Come on, we're not safe here. We've got to go.
Corinne pulled free, still laughing.
Where are we going?
Anywhere. Away from here. Come on.
Jodie grabbed her arm and tried to tow her along the gravel.
No.
Corinne snatched out of her grip.
What do you mean, go? There's nowhere to go. And what about the bags?
Oh, shit, the bags. She'd forgotten the bags. Okay, we'll take them with us. Jodie picked up the closest one, hauled its strap over her shoulder, hefted a thermal bag full of food over her other shoulder. Fear was making her strong. Superwoman, she could carry 10 of them. She grabbed 2 more, pushed another one at Corinne.
Here, take this. Come on.
Corinne stepped away.
No, I'm not going anywhere. Over there is as dark as over here. There's no reason why I should stumble around in my new ankle boots just to go stand in another dark spot.
Jodie's heart thumped in her chest. The tips of her fingers tingled as though the adrenaline racing around inside was about to burst through the skin. They're just memories, very old memories. Pre-kids, pre-uni, a lifetime ago. Get a grip. Take a breath. She pulled in a lungful of air, snapped out the handle of a wheelie bag and leaned on it. Okay. She was freaked out, infused with pulse-racing fear. But this was still a bad place to wait, and she wanted to get them out of there. She tried to make her voice even, reasoned. The first rule of self-defense is not to be there. And right here, we're sitting ducks. I should have seen it earlier. Look. She pointed to the right, where the crest of the hill met the dark sky, then left to the right-angled bend where the lines in the road disappeared. Between the hill and the corner, we're totally obscured. There's bush right up to both sides of the road, and it's so dark we can barely see each other.
But don't you see? We have to stand on the edge of the road for the taxi to see us, but we can't tell if it's a taxi until it's already on us. Some freak could take that as an invitation for a cheap thrill and run us down, or worse, drag us into a car. And unless another vehicle drives through here at that same moment, which is pretty damn unlikely since we've only seen 2 cars in half an hour, no one will know we're here. We could be dying in the dirt and the cabbie would drive right past us. We have to find a better place to wait.
Calm down, Jodie. You've been teaching too many of those self-defense classes,
Corinne said, still not moving. Jodie pursed her lips at Corinne's tone. Her self-defense course wasn't offered for a fun alternative on sports days. She was trying to save lives, teaching what she wished she'd known 18 years ago. I'd be pretty stupid not to take my own advice, don't you think? Corinne shook her head.
Okay, look, I know this isn't the pick of places to wait for a cab, but surely it's better than wandering around in the dark.
No, it wasn't. It was dark and creepy and all wrong here.
Doing something is better than nothing. Moving is better than standing still. I want to start walking towards Bald Hill, and I'm not leaving you behind.
She would never do that again.
So come on.
Too late, she recognised the irritating playground tone of her voice, took a breath, tried to lighten the mood.
Besides, walking will warm us up, and we might get better reception when we get over the hill. And if you don't come, I'll knock you out and drag you by your new boots, and you know I can do that.
Please, Corinne. Corinne sighed.
Okay, if that's what you want, but if I ruin my boots, you can pay for a new pair.
Jodie passed her a bag.
Thank you, and you better walk carefully because I can't afford a new pair of your boots.
She helped Corinne load up with as many bags as she would carry and took the rest herself. The high tide of fear began to recede once they were moving. Her eyes adjusted a little more as they followed the white roadside markers. She could make out the long ribbon of road, the line of bush on the other side, the charcoal cover of sky. Her heart slowed, and the howling in her head eased a little. She still had the superwoman's strength, but dragging 2 wheelie bags along the gravel with the thermal bag on one shoulder and a pillow under the other, made for slow going.
"Do you have to go so fast?"
Corinne called from behind. Jodie tried to ignore the urge to grab Corinne's hand and run for safety and forced herself to cut her pace.
"Let's cross the road and try the phone again," Jodie said, and veered onto the bitumen.
She dragged her wheelie bags over the lip, felt them fall into line behind her on the smooth surface.
"We should walk on the road after I've called Louise. It's a lot easier," she called over her shoulder as she manoeuvred the cases onto the dirt on the other side.
Behind her, she heard Corinne's boots clomp onto the road, followed by the bump of her suitcase and a hum of wheels as she crossed the tarmac. Then came a sudden scatter of gravel, and Corinne cried out. Jodie turned, took a moment to decipher the shadows in front of her. Corinne was sprawled on the dirt, a wheelie case upended, and a smaller bag flung across her. Jodie dropped her baggage and skidded to her side.
"I turned my ankle."
Corinne's voice was tight with pain. Jodie placed a hand gently under the back of Corinne's boot to support the ankle, took the bag from her shoulder and helped her sit.
"How bad is it?" "It hurts like hell."
"Can you move your toes?" She took a second to answer.
Yes. Did I break it?"
"If you can move your toes, you've probably just sprained it."
"I mean my boot. Did I break the heel?"
"Are you serious?"
"Yes. They're Italian. They cost a fortune."
Jodie felt under the boot, found a dangling spiked heel.
"Yes, you broke the heel."
She looked up at the crest of the hill that now loomed above them, then down the road to the bend, and felt the fear rev up again. This was a worse place to be. Too close to the crest, too close to the edge of the tar. The bush was nearer to the road on this side, and it seemed darker somehow. They wouldn't need a freak looking for a cheap thrill to knock them down. Anyone coming over the hill too fast could plough right into them.
"Do you think you can walk?" "Jesus, Jodie, I've just sprained my ankle. Can you give me a second?"
Jodie shut her eyes. Corinne was angry, but it didn't change their situation. They needed to move. She gently rubbed Corinne's ankle.
"I'm sorry. I know it's hurting, but it isn't safe here. We should at least move off the road a bit further."
Corinne pushed Jodie's hand away.
"We should have stayed where we were."
Jodie shot to her feet.
"No, you should have been more careful. Why did you wear bloody spike heels for a weekend in the country anyway? What were you expecting? A nightclub?"
Her heart pounded and her stomach tightened like it was waiting for a blow. She turned sharply, took half a dozen steps along the gravel. "What are you doing, Jodie?" Corinne was just being Corinne. Her narcissistic streak was usually good for a bit of a laugh. Right now, though, Jodie wanted to shake it out of her.
"Get a grip, for God's sake. Losing your cool will not help."
She walked back to Corinne. She was sitting on the edge of the bitumen, her hurt ankle propped on her opposite knee. Her chin jutted out indignantly. She didn't look up, didn't speak.
"Shit, she's really mad,"
Jodie thought. She stood on the edge of the road and stared at the double yellow lines disappearing over the hill. Jodie hadn't felt scared like this in a long time. She'd worked through all that crap. What the hell was happening? The near miss and almost killing her best friends had started it. A thing like that would throw anyone off balance. Then there was the hurry to get the keys for the B&B and getting left with Corinne when she was the least likely to be practical in a bad situation. Now Jodie had made it worse by freaking out and dragging Corinne around in her ankle-breaker boots.
"Okay, Jodie, think it through. Make some better decisions."
She turned a slow circle. Corinne was still sitting on the edge of the road, still saying nothing. That situation needed mending for a start. Corinne had no idea what was going on in Jodie's head. She didn't need to know. It was Jodie's own private freakout, and she didn't want to dump it on a friend. The crest of the hill was a dark line in the night sky, a short upward slope, and Hannah's mobile was in her pocket. She took it out and held it up in the air. Not even one bar. Jodie ran a hand through her hair, felt the dampness in it from the cold night air. Okay, doing something always felt better than doing nothing. She squatted beside Corinne.
I'm sorry I made you walk around in the dark. And I'm sorry I yelled at you. I just don't like it here.
Corinne looked up at her.
And your shoes aren't stupid.
I'd buy a pair myself if I thought I could walk in them. She tried to inject a smile into her voice.
How's your ankle? It feels like I jammed it in a car door. I don't think I can walk. Then I think we should try to move you and the bags away from the road. And then I'm going to the top of the hill to see if I can get better reception up there. Are you okay with that?
Corinne shrugged.
If it'll stop you prattling on about it.
Jodie took a second, decided not to comment. She helped Corinne away from the road, made several trips to move all the bags, then kept the phone in her hand to watch for reception as she began the jog up the hill. The fear was like a straitjacket now, making her stiff as she ran, making her breath jerk in and out, refusing to let it settle into its usual running rhythm. But running felt a damn sight better than standing and waiting, like she had some control. She stopped at the top.
Hallelujah, 3 bars,
she yelled to Corinne and counted 5 rings before Louise answered.
Hey, guys, about time you got here.
She was somewhere noisy, sounding happy.
We're not. We're still waiting for the taxi, Jodie said.
What?
It wasn't a shock-horror exclamation, but a please repeat.
I said, hang on, I can't hear you.
Jodie squeezed her eyes shut. She'd wanted Louise to cry, don't panic, a chopper will be there to rescue you within the minute, not hang about while I turn the volume down.
We're in the pub and there's a bourbon and coke here with your name on it, Louise said. We're still waiting for the fucking cab, Jodie snapped,
then wished she hadn't. She knew it wasn't Lou's fault, but cheery was beyond her emotional range right now.
Oh my God, I thought you were at the service station.
Jodie heard Hannah in the background, and Louise repeated the fucking cab bit.
Hang on, Hannah's asking someone about the taxi.
Jodie heard muffled voices, then some kind of shocked exchange between Hannah and Louise. Lou came back on.
The taxi left ages ago. Someone at the pub's been trying to call him. He's not answering his mobile. No one knows where he is.
Jodie tried to rein in the panic that was brewing in the back of her head.
Get someone out here, Lou. Now.
Chapter 4. Matt flicked the wipers for a swipe at the mist that was almost a light rain. Bad night for Jodie Cramer and her friend to be sitting by the side of a road. He eased his foot harder on the accelerator, glad he'd brought his car instead of the tow truck this time. It would get him there a lot faster. He shouldn't have left them. He knew it at the time, but their concern about getting the key had made him ignore his instincts. That was the problem. He didn't trust his instincts anymore. And the problem with that was that he'd always acted on gut feeling. The police psychologist called it an emergency reflex, but what would she know about being in a tight corner? He glanced at his reflection in the dark passenger window. If he couldn't rely on his gut, he couldn't do his job anymore. Just a loss of confidence, the psychologist had said. Matt said ditto. What would she know? She'd never even fired a gun. Matt topped the crest of the hill and pulled up sharply. Jodie and the other woman were sitting on their luggage at the side of the road. What were they doing there? Why not just stand in the middle of the road and ask to be run down? At least his instincts had left them in a safer place. His tyres crunched on the gravel as he steered off the road. Jodie stood as he reversed back. So she wasn't the one who'd hurt an ankle. Standing there, with her feet firmly planted and her hands stuffed in her coat pockets, he guessed it'd take more than a walk in the dark to knock her off her pins. "Need a lift?" he called as he stepped out of the car. "About an hour ago," she called back, and the tone of her voice said they weren't having a party out here. When he'd walked over, she said,
"What happened to the damn cab?"
"A tree." Matt waited a beat while she opened her mouth and closed it again, as the concept took some of the heat out of her reproach.
"The cabbie hit a tree?"
"Yeah. You're lucky it happened before he picked you up, or you'd have more than a tumble in the dirt to worry about."
"Is he all right?"
"He's on his way to hospital, but a broken leg seems to be the worst of it." Up close, the two of them looked cold and damp, and the cheery mood on his first trip out had definitely taken a hike. The other woman was sitting on a suitcase with one foot propped on a bag. Her shoe was still on, and the leg of her jeans was pulled down over the ankle, so he couldn't tell how bad the injury was, but from the way she was huddled in her coat, she looked like she'd probably die of cold before the pain got her. He knelt on one knee beside her, kept his bad knee angled away.
"What happened?"
She shot Jodie a look, the kind that implied she'd already had a few words to say on that matter.
"Jodie didn't like it back down there, thought we'd be safer if we took a walk."
She rolled her eyes. Matt frowned up at Jodie.
"Probably better if you'd stayed where you were. You're sitting ducks here. I was lucky to see you."
"Thanks for that. I'll try to remember next time I'm stranded out here."
She gave him a tight smile.
"Right now, Corinne needs to get to the car. Can you give me a hand?"
He looked back at Corinne.
"How bad is it? Do you need a hospital?"
"A hot spa would be my first choice, but Bald Hill will do. I think it's just a sprain."
She held a hand out to him.
"I'm Corinne, by the way, and I'm very happy to meet you again."
"Matt Wiseman," he said,
taking her hand, lifting her to her feet.
"Nothing like a bit of excitement on a Friday night, hey?"
She curled one arm around his neck, the other over Jodie's, and used the two of them as crutches. After half a dozen steps, he could see it would take them an age like that.
"I've got a better idea," he said,
hooked an arm under her knees and picked her up.
"Oh, I didn't expect that. Are you sure? You're limping yourself."
"It's no big deal," he said,
figuring a little more physio wouldn't hurt. She fastened her arms around his neck, purred into his ear.
"Well then, you can come to my rescue any day."
Matt chuckled. The helpless female thing had never really appealed, but a good-looking woman in his arms was better than a kick in the head for his efforts tonight. He helped her into the back of the car, left her arranging her leg along the seat, and found Jodie strong-arming a suitcase into the boot. He reached in to give her a hand, bumped her as he heaved against the weight, and on contact, she snapped her arm away. He looked up in surprise. She took a step back, stood with her feet apart, arms at her sides, fists bunched like she was ready to throw a punch. That was one hell of a defense reflex. As he straightened, she took another couple of steps back, looked away like she wasn't sure what to do, then turned and walked to the pile of luggage. They collected the rest of the bags, and she stayed to the side while he loaded the car. No more nasty bumps that way, Matt guessed. He let her find her own way around to the passenger door, half expecting her to be sitting with her friend when he climbed into the driver's seat. but she was next to him, already belted in. As he fumbled with the keys, she dragged both hands through her hair, ran them over her face, held them there a second as she pulled in a deep breath. He started the engine and said, "Everything okay?" She folded her arms across her chest before she turned her face to him.
"Yep, great."
She smiled a little. It looked like it took some work, like she had to unclench her jaw before her lips would soften into a curl. The effort was worth it, though, and made up for her keep-your-distance act outside.
"Thanks for coming to get us."
"No problem."
He U-turned onto the bitumen and picked up speed on the familiar road. Beside him, Jodie rubbed her hands up and down her arms, crossed her legs. He turned the heating up a couple of notches.
"Thanks," she said. "How's my car?"
"It's seen better days."
"Is there any chance you could patch it up so I can drive home on Sunday?"
Matt shrugged.
"Can't answer that. You'll have to wait till the old man takes a look at it in the morning. He's the mechanic. I'm just the hired help. Depends what parts he's got, but I'd suggest you talk to him before you make other arrangements."
Corinne spoke up from the back seat.
"I'm more concerned about how we get to our cottage tonight. What do we do if there's no taxi?"
Matt ran his hand over the stubble on his chin.
"I could run you over. Where are you staying?"
"The old barn on the hill," Jodie said.
"Do you know it?"
The barn on the hill? Bloody hell. In his head, he saw its small, boxy shape, the unpainted timber frame, the crude steps up to the front door, and his gut tightened. It must have changed some if it was being rented to tourists.
"Yeah, I know it. Hope it's in better condition than the last time I saw it."
When was that? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.